आदरणीय भारत का गृहमंत्री श्री राजनाथ सिंह जी और श्री हंसराज अहिर जी, हमारा आर्मी चीफ लेफ्टिनेंट जनरल बिपिन रावत जी, आपका निर्देशक एनआईए का श्री योगेश चंद्र मोदी जी और इस समारोह में भाग लेने वाले सभी महानुभाव देवी और सज्जनों, मैं राजनाथ जी का और मोदी जी का, आपका मोदी जी का भाषण हिंदी में सुना है, इसलिए मैंने सोचा है ये एनआईए ऐसा जटिल विषय है, इसलिए मैं थोड़ी देर अंग्रेजी में बोलूं। और जो लोग ये मिसचीफ कर रहे उनको ज़्यादा अंग्रेजी मालूम है, बाहर से और अंदर से भी। बिफोर आई स्टार्ट माय लेक्चर, आई वुड लाइक टू थैंक द एनआईए, पर्टिकुलरली आई एम टेम्प्टेड टू से माय फ्रेंड, बट नाउ आई कांट फ्रीली यूज दैट वर्ड्स, मिस्टर राजनाथ सिंह जी, बिकॉज आई एम ऑल्सो चेयरमैन ऑफ द राज्यसभा। And tomorrow somebody may say, because his friend is been lenient, there is no need for to be lenient with him because he is efficient by all means as the Home Minister of India and also knowledge wise about all the subjects also. We have been working together. Of course, now I am not there in his party. I am now out of politics. I resigned from party politics, but I am active in public life. I feel really happy to come this important function because it is a memorial lecture. Memory, remembering the people who have done great service has been the culture of India. And also honoring or presenting medals to some of the people who have given distinguished service, that's also part of our culture. Pratibha Puraskar, a Bharatiya Samskruti ka ek ang hai. By giving a medal or a certificate, what is it they are going to get? This is to give inspiration to others. This felicitation is to give inspiration to others. You also work hard, you will also be recognized. That is the purpose of this felicitation program. And I compliment NIA and its director for this initiative that has been going on. Friends, I congratulate the medal awardees who have rendered outstanding service to the NIA and our country. Their professionalism and dedication and devotion should inspire the others in this organization to scale new heights and set new benchmarks of excellence. Rajnath ji was telling about performance of 95% and hoping for 100%, because there is always a scope for improvement and the challenges are increasing as we are moving forward. Two things are happening. One is aspirations. Now it's an aspirational India. People want excellence. They are not satisfied with the good performance, better performance, best performance. They want outstanding performance. That's the expectation. Good performance also a very good thing that way. Secondly, the challenges are also increasing manifold. India is moving forward. Some people are not able to digest it, including one of our neighbor. The entire world economy is a little slow down. But according to all the reports, whether it is IMF, today's report, yesterday's report, or the World Bank, or the Moody's ratings, not Moody's ratings. And also the other assessments that are made from time to time, India is on the move. And in the coming 3 years, no wonder India will surpass even the other powerful neighbor, China. That's the information. And we have confirmation also for that information, because everywhere same is the case. And you have seen in Davos also how India was welcomed by the people, and Indian story was held by one and all. The government of India is making all the efforts, political level. The Prime Minister has invited all the SAARC countries for his swearing-in ceremony, a very good gesture that shows we want to be friendly with all our neighbors. Secondly, tomorrow, the day of tomorrow's Republic Day, we invited all the Asian leaders. I think first time such a thing is happening. All the important heads of the Asian countries, ASEAN countries, are all coming here. And India, if you go through civilization, we don't have the history of attacking anybody. We are one of the oldest civilizations. Why I'm giving this background is people should know this. The countrymen should know this. And also our neighbors also should be reminded. India's GDP was 27% of the world GDP before the invasion by others. 27% of the world GDP was from India. We had such trade, such wealth. And then after the invasion of the others, what has happened to India? And now we are struggling hard to become 7.2, 7.4, and then planning to become double digit in coming years. This is the historical part. Even with the troubling neighbor also, we always try to talk. And also, in spite of our provocations, we were trying to make a friendship with them, with us, as Sriman Atal Bihari Vajpayee ji has said, you can change your friends, but you can't change your neighbors. That's the problem. And the Prime Minister also has gone out of the way. You might have seen that he not only called them for Asia, our swearing in, and he also had a sudden stopover at Lahore while coming back from other country. This never happened without any notice. To attend a family function, he wants to send a signal that we Indians, we want to be friendly with all. We have no enmity with anybody. But in spite of that, what is happening? So that's a big challenge for us, along with the internal challenges here and there by extremists, by fundamentalists, by also some of the divisive forces that is there. Our neighbor want to aid, abet, fund, train terrorists. It's very clear. There's no need to feel shy or try to be goody-goody. It's very crystal clear the world should realize that they have made this as a state policy. And they want to see that India is subverted, weakened, crippled economically. Other than this, there is no other reason. As rightly said by Sri Rajnath Singh ji, wo kabhi bhi swapna bhi nahi soch sakte, kabhi bhi Jammu Kashmir ya Bharat ka koi pradesh unka paas jayega, ye to sambhavna to hai nahi. This will never happen. Not even an inch of Indian land can be allowed to be taken by those people. That's very clear, crystal clear. Friends, R.V. Raju was the first DG of this premier counter-terrorism investigating agency, because terror is increasing worldwide. Once upon a time, we used to be the victims. Others used to just simply condone, send condolences. Condolence for the dead, compensation for the survived. That used to be the policy. Now the approach has changed. It has to change further. We can no longer tolerate this sort of nonsense. And other countries also now have realized, the West has realized. Earlier, in spite of the pain that we are getting, they were not able to appreciate our difficulties. Now not the West, the Europe, everywhere, every country for that matter, except one or few. Their turn also may come, we don't know. This is happening worldwide. So terror is a threat to the humanity. Terror has no religion. Terror has no region. When I said terror has no region, I saw social media reacting very strongly. Sir, how do you explain this? They have not read my second sentence. Terror has no religion, but some terrorists are trying to take the cover under religion. It's a fact. They want to cover up their heinous crimes by taking shelter under religion, by indoctrinating the youngsters in the name of religion, though no religion, to my knowledge, accepts terror. No religion preaches terror. But unfortunately, religion is being used. Otherwise, how do you explain this ISIS? How do you explain some of these activities by some of these people and then trying to take shelter, cover under religion, and what is happening in Jammu Kashmir? How they connected to religion? What is religion in this? Throwing thrones, is it written in any Bhagavad Gita or Guru Granth Sahib or Quran or any other pustak? No. But they are trying to, and then unfortunately some people are falling prey to that. In addition to this, media also sometimes to sensationalize, sometimes this angle also is brought in. This is one of the challenges before the nation. We must also understand the basic principle: peace and progress go together. If there is tension on the border or internally, if there is tension, there cannot be attention towards development. These two things are very simple. This is not a new theory I am trying to present before you. Tension and attention cannot go together, even if it is in the house also. Peace and progress, they go together. So we are a peace-loving nation. We have the history, we have the culture. We believe in Vasudhaika Kutumbam. We believe in Sarve Jana Sukhino Bhavantu. We respect each creature, including Pasu Paksha. Unko bhi hum log puja karte is desh mein. Even animal. Kanumu Pandaga, the Sankranti festival we had just now. This is a festival for animal also. And we also adore trees, plants also. That's the culture of this country. We don't intend any harm to anybody. So that being the case, how these things are happening. Because some people wrongly believe that power comes through barrel of the gun. It can never. Even if it comes, it will not last on more than few minutes, few hours or few days. The bullet which you feel that you will get power will kill you tomorrow. Only question of time. So, and it has been proved worldwide that ballot is more powerful than bullet. Very clear, mighty rulers who thought that they are indispensable, very powerful, they were made powerless by that ballot. Simple. It simply goes in and then comes out, your fate is sealed. Your means not those politicians. Fate is sealed. So these things has to be understood by one and all. You can never achieve the so-called Maoists or the revolutionaries. What is revolution? Killing innocent people. Is it revolution? It is neither revolution nor an evolution or a solution. And secondly, you cannot finish any religion by such hatred. And if you think that your religion is great, Swami Vivekananda said that the moment you thought they were great, you were finishing other religion, then that means you are finished yourself. So these basic things have to be understood, and then we have to go on telling the people about our belief, our conviction, and what our forefathers have told us. So national security environment India is determined by global geographical attributes, socio-economic milieu, as well as regional and global developments. It's not simply in your hands. You don't believe that alone will not suffice. India is the seventh largest country in the world in terms of area. Second most populous country in terms of population. The third largest economy in terms of purchasing power, parity, PPP. And one of the oldest civilization with unparalleled cultural, religious, ethnic and linguistic diversity. India shares its land boundaries with six countries, while it shares its maritime boundaries with seven countries. It is in this context that we should understand the national security challenges that India faces in the 21st century. The national security challenges can be broadly categorized as internal challenges and external challenges, as I was explaining, both of which are closely intricately intertwined. The internal challenges include the growing radicalization in some sections, not all, of the society, some separatist movements. Separatist means I am not talking about a separate state agitation, etc. Separation from the country. And then the insurgencies, communalism, and the so-called Maoist or extremist violence. We have centuries old rich cultural ethos that is rooted in strong democratic principles which eschew violence in all its forms. However, there are certain misguided elements who continue to use violence as an instrument to achieve political goals. No matter what the grievances are, disgruntled people or sections of the people, there are always means to resolve all issues lawfully and peacefully within our constitutional scheme. That has been proved world over. Having said that, I would like to point out that of immediate concern to all of us on the internal security front is the growing radicalization in some sections of the society. This has roots in a distorted view of religion and ethnic identity. How do you explain otherwise educated people taking to this sort of route and also trying to go out and then wage a so-called war in which they are going to die? We have witnessed this phenomena in the unending spiral violence in different parts of our country, including the Kashmir Valley, in the insurgent movements in the northeast region, and the left-wing extremism affected areas in the hinterland. The efforts made by the government have helped to contain the situation in Kashmir, as just now the Honorable Home Minister was explaining. There also has been a significant decline in the incidence of violence by Maoists, and the northeast is largely, by and large, peaceful. The IM was one of the successful initiatives. The Naga rebels and talks with them, NSC and IM, was one of the successful initiatives and shows how long festering political issues can be resolved peacefully to the advantage of all. Friends, as you know, India is now fastest growing economy. India needs to grow faster to provide basic means of livelihood and decent opportunity to all its citizens. We believe in inclusive growth. That's why government is taking so many steps to eradicate poverty, to take care of illiteracy, and to end the regional imbalances, and also to end the discrimination on the basis of caste, creed, sex, religion, and region. And the entire society, fortunately, is in that mood now, that we're all joining together. In spite of political differences, states being ruled by different parties, there is a broad consensus as far as the national unity and integrity of the country is concerned, and also to large extent about the reforms also. So the mantra PM has given about reform, perform, and transform society, that is now taking shape speedily. So for that, the basic thing is safety to all. Feeling of safety also is much required. Friends, as you know, the need of the hour is to ensure that India remains peaceful so that the process of all-round development continues unhindered. We must be eternally vigilant against forces which are inimical to India and want to derail the country's onward march. Stopping roads, stopping doctors from attending hospitals, stopping the teachers from coming to schools. What sort of revolution it is, I am not able to understand. The so-called intellectuals who have joined that movement, I don't know why they are not able to understand this basic principle. The backward areas of Jharkhand, backward areas of Chhattisgarh, backward areas of Maharashtra, backward areas of Odisha, and backward areas of Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. One of the reasons is this violence. Frightens people to go and serve there in spite. And then destroying the public infrastructure. It's no solution, it's no revolution at all. Nowhere it happened. It's a mindless violence. It should be curbed. Friends, in this century, we have to be more vigilant. I must say, eternally vigilant against forces which are inimical to India and want to derail the country's onward march. That's why I use the word that one of our neighbors want to subvert India, cripple our economy. In this country, wars are, and these groups are all cooperating with each other at times. That also has to be understood. And in this century, wars are not fought in the battlefield alone. They are fought on all fronts, including the economic front. Economic warfare is one of the most potent tools to undermine the peace and security of a nation and damage caused by its immense. With regard to the external threats faced by the country, our neighborhood remains the biggest challenge for our national security. The cross-border terrorism through both state and non-state actors has claimed thousands of innocent lives over the last three decades. One of our neighbor countries continue, as I told you, to follow that policy in spite of all this. Friends, the Indian economy is trying to be damaged monetarily through production and smuggling and circulation of counterfeit Indian currency notes also. The National Investigating Agency, in its investigations in the Pathankot, Uri and Andhwara terrorist attacks cases and in number of counterfeit Indian currency notes cases, have conclusively proved the role of the neighboring country in orchestrating the attacks and producing and circulating the counterfeit currency. I congratulate the NIA for its splendid performance and professional investigation, which has exposed the machinations of various terrorist groups in this country. The dynamics of international terrorism have changed, with certain groups using cyber communication to spread their ideology. This led to a completely new era in terrorism world over. The phenomena of foreign terrorist fighters, or the FTF and the lone wolf attacks, taking place in many parts of the world like never before. The attacks in France, Belgium, UK, and in Bangladesh, to name a few, made us realize that the age of internet or cyber communication, national boundaries are no barriers for terrorists to propagate, to recruit, to plan, and to carry out attacks anywhere and at any time of their choice. I am told that the NIA has registered and investigated cases which a number of intricate conspiracies hatched in cyberspace were busted, and a number of potential terrorists both within and beyond India were arrested. The cyber revolution, while bringing immense benefits, has also created certain vulnerabilities and risks. The cyberspace transcends the national boundaries, hence it is extremely difficult to exercise effective jurisdictional control over the same. The proliferation of internet-based social media platforms and communication tools by terrorist outfits for planning and execution of terrorist incidents have further accelerated the situation. With internet services providers operating transnationally across multiple jurisdictions, the only effective way to tackle globally active terrorist individuals and outfits is through international cooperation. This can be done by developing uniform standards and norms for internet service providers and technology companies, with the nation states facilitating information sharing to fight against terrorism. Surveillance, intelligence gathering, and adequate preemptive and preventive measures by security agencies at a global level are very much required. The United Nations has from time to time adopted various resolutions to combat global terrorism in all its formats. However, despite being members of the United Nations, some member states continue to flout these resolutions by nurturing and providing support to terrorist organizations. It is time for the global community to take note of the situation and act against such errant member states. It's everybody's knowledge who is encouraging, who is aiding, who is funding, who is training terrorists. And the UN has been going on discussing. People are becoming, I must tell you, restive. This is not the opinion of Vice President of India. It is the people's opinion, how long these deliberations, why we are not able to come together, why the world is not able to speak with one voice and curb this menace. How can you justify terror on one border and then criticize the terror on the other border? This is happening in our case also, in the case of our neighbor also. So this time, the high time that the United Nations muster the will and then kill this terror. You need to have political will, administrative skill, and also change of mindset among the people. This has to be taken up as a movement by all the countries in the globe, because each one of them are becoming victims of the same. Friends, the recent investigation by the NIA in tracing and tracking the funding of separatist groups and leaders have successfully disrupted the supply of funds to the separatist groups. They were caught naked. I use the word intentionally. And it's a good step taken by NIA and the support given by the country and by some people may, some politicians there will be going on discussing, they will be criticizing. Okay, let them do it. But as far as the nation is concerned, nation is very happy that this step is long overdue. And the NIA, through its investigation, was able to really correct the needed evidence, and then they have now come out with the specific instances. There is much more to be done on this front, because you know that the supply of funds to the separatist groups, to the extremist groups, or to the divisive forces is also an important aspect. Unless you demolish that supply chain, and these people are very intelligent, they function in very names and they use the different platforms. When they were caught, they will say human rights are under attack. When they kill others, no. So routine hai, hota hai. There's also another weakness in certain sections of our intelligentsia. They don't open their mouth and people are brutally killed, bombed. Number of people lose their lives and they raise their voice whenever there something happens. And they go to the extent of condemning Indian Army, and including attacks on the Indian Army chief. But fortunately, the public opinion of the country is totally with the armed forces, who are doing a great job, and we should all salute Indian Army for the great service they are doing to the country. We are having peaceful sleep today because of they are not having sleep and guarding our borders. This has to be understood. And the officers in NIA, or officers in the other investigating agencies, including the other paramilitary forces, they are giving their life to protect the country. If there is something goes wrong, there is a mechanism, internal mechanism, that will take care of the same if somebody does something wrong totally. But blowing them out of proportion and damning the forces is not in the national interest. I am very clear about it. As I am not yet there in politics, I can speak more freely. People may say, sir, there is a protocol and all. So, protocol? Protocol, national interest, safety and security, unity of the country is more important than anything else. And there should not be any compromise. And there should be zero tolerance towards terror and to extremism and to violence. For anything. Clearly. And the nation must stand with such officers. If there is something wrong, the courts are there. The matter will go to, it's not the NIA which is going to give you punishment, na. They have made out a case, corrected information with confirmation. And then judiciary is there. We are a vibrant democracy, the largest vibrant democracy in the world. Nowhere human rights are this much assured than India. People, irrespective of their belief, they are given equal opportunities. I need not explain in detail how the top positions of the country at various levels were occupied by different sections of the people. That is the beauty of Indian democracy. That is the beauty of Indian democracy. Some people try to mislead the people, trying to rake up caste issues, communal issues, regional issues and all. Genuine problems, yes. Identities, yes. But at the end of the day, we are one. We may have different languages. As a country, we are one. Alag bhasha, alag vesh, phir bhi apana ek desh. Vividhata mein ekata, Bharat ka vishesha. We should live as a nation. We should think as a nation. We should act as a nation. Act as a nation. Suppose your toe, there is some small injury. Toe, na? Why should mind think about it? Why should head bow? Why should back bend? Why should the hand go and then touch that and see what has happened there? Because you are one body. Same thing, whatever is happening in Kashmir or Kanyakumari, India is one. We are concerned about our people. That feeling has to be there among all the people. That's why the divisive forces, then people are saying, sir, dissent is not allowed. Dissent is agreeable, dissent is allowed, dissent is welcome. Disintegration cannot be accepted at all. This has to be very clear to one and all. You cannot celebrate Afzal Gurus. Afzal Guru, aapka kaam jo adhura raha hai, usko pura karenge. Kya adhura raha hai? Venkaiah Naidu, Rajnath Singh, Advani,
बाकी जो महानुभाव प्रधानमंत्री सब विपक्ष का और स्वपक्ष का बच गए उसको पूरा करना यही अधूरा है क्या वॉट इज दिस नॉनसेंस आई एम नॉट एबल टू अंडरस्टैंड हाउ कैन यू जस्ट ऑफ सेलिब्रेटिंग समबडी गुड मेमम्स हु ट्राई टू किल पीपल विदाउट रीजन इनोसेंट पीपल वॉट इज द आइडिया जी वॉट इज द फिलोसफी आई रियली वंडर समटाइम्स हाउ सच पीपल कैन बी सिंपथाइज्ड या डिसेंट यस You have a disagreement? Yes. There is a disagreement now. It's evident everywhere. We are seeing also. Even in parliament, outside, you can agree to disagree. You can talk out and walk out, but no breakout. Otherwise, it will be all out of the system and the country. We have to think as a nation. With all our great history of civilization, and also the challenges we have, and also the intelligence we have in this country. There is intellect among every section of the society. I go to sometimes in states, and I find there in Silicon Valley, every second person is an Indian there. IT has become now the beauty of India, and if you make it as your duty, then you will become mighty also, even in the IT also. But IT also affects us, as we were discussing about it. All this challenges are there before us. That's why this agency is, you do something in Coimbatore and then you come to Andhra Pradesh and create trouble here. That police cannot come here even if they come also, there's no cooperation. Without cooperation, you cannot have operation. And in between that separation. So you need to have a, so after so much discussion, the parliament has approved this NIA bill. There were two views at that time. This is against federal system and all. Hit and run. They are not confined to your one state or one district or one language. Hit there and run here. Change your name also, sometimes change the religion also. We have seen recently some of the incidents. These people are coming with new methods, new ideas, out-of-box ideas. Prime Minister is talking about out-of-box ideas here, and they are also planning their own out-of-box ideas there. You have incubation, innovation, stand-up, start-up, all, but they are also up with their own plans. So we have to be very intelligent and we have to be really, our investigating agencies has to be given more power and they should be given that liberty and also there should be transparency, I do agree. Transparency and accountability is very vital for any system, including these agencies. But you cannot have a running commentary. You cannot have a running commentary. Today, global terrorism is the biggest threat as internationally active terrorist groups aspire to destroy the democratic world order by using all forms of violence. These terrorist groups do not believe in quality, equality and justice and would adopt all means, propagate, advance and impose their ideologies which are antithetical to democratic values. Considering the various dimensions of terrorism in India, the world as it exists today, it is extremely important to build capacities, import training, upgrade skills, provide technological expertise to security forces and law enforcing agencies. Positive engagement with our foreign partners is necessary when it comes to fighting the scourge of global terrorism. Terrorists around the world are collaborating and adopting technology to carry out their nefarious activities surreptitiously. Therefore, it is incumbent upon law enforcement agencies and security agencies all over the world to collaborate with each other to defeat international terrorism. For decades, India has fought the scourge of terrorism with fortitude and firm resolve. The success of India and its security forces in bringing peace to the states of Northeast Punjab, containing situation Kashmir, and also parts of the hinterland affected with left-wing extremism speaks volumes of the deft handling of the situation by our security forces and agencies. We have made numerous sacrifices in our fight. How many people have died? When you receive a body from the border, your heart is broken. What happened to that family? What is the sacrifice they are doing? For whose sake? That's why we should remember those great sacrifices. I also personally feel, I don't know whether I should say it or not, some amount of training should be given to all people, like other countries in our country also. I don't use the word military training, but some training to think about the country and also develop that habit from the childhood itself about the security, about also the ability and also stability and also practice. Everything making them into controversy. Yoga means again controversy. Yoga is an Indian art. Yoga has nothing to do with the religion. Some people say, I have objection to Surya Namaskara. You have objection to Surya Namaskara, na? Do Chandra Namaskara, no problem. Or you do Swayam Namaskara yourself. Namaskara is our samskara, Indian samskara. There are some people have the habit of each and everything, they try to give a narrow meaning and try to look it from their prism of their this thing only. They, of course, we are a democracy. We have arguments also, counter-arguments also, and the best will emerge out of it. So, friends, the robust and strong legal framework against terrorists enforced by institutions with all the required infrastructure and human resources is a sine qua non for providing a befitting response to terrorism. Reorganizing, recognizing the same, the domestic legal framework against terrorism in India has been strengthened from time to time by successive governments. The government is in the process of making further amendments to anti-terror law to empower law enforcement agencies to not only ensure effective investigation in terrorist cases, but also have fruitful prosecution to meet the ends of justice. At the end of this thing, I only say that let us congratulate the officers and the personnel of the NIA on the occasion of NIA's day and hope that it will continue to do the good work and achieve greater success in their endeavor to unearth terrorist conspiracies, apprehend the guilty who are responsible for death and destruction, and bring them to justice and ensure peace and prosperity to the country. Because as I told you, the onward march for the progress should not be halted. Second, peace and progress will go together. Third, if there is tension, there cannot be attention. These things have to be remembered by one and all, and the citizens of the country. Everyone, the other day Prime Minister gave an advice, simple advice. Pahle maine socha isme hai kya? He said everyone has to do their duty satisfactory. Har ek vyakti apna kartavya ko nishtha se karna chahiye. Simple. And you read that, if everybody does their act in the interest of the society, in his own interest, in the interest of the country, then the country will definitely prosper. Nobody can stop India that way. Aur hamara paas koi mahatvakanksha bhi nahi hai. Isliye koi parishan bhi nahi hai usme. To isliye mitro, main aur ek bar aaj yahan श्री मोदी जी को योगेश चंद्र मोदी जी को और गृह मंत्रालय को और सभी अधिकारियों को मुझे जो अवकाश आप लोगों ने दिया यहाँ बुलाया इसके लिए मैं धन्यवाद देना चाहता हूँ और आप सबको भी अभिनंदन करना चाहता हूँ विद दिस एंटायर वीक टुडे इज अ सूर्य जयंती सन रेस Not the S-O-N, S-U-N. Race is very important for humanity. And secondly, yesterday was the Jayanti of the great son of this great country, Sri Subhash Chandra Bose. He's one great leader. He's one great leader whose Jayanti we celebrate. We do not know what was his Vardhanti. And you had Vasanta Panchami. You are now about to reach Republic Day. All this should make us to resolve every countryman, every serving personnel, every officer, that they should do their best for the sake of the country so that the country can prosper well, progress well, and fulfill the aim of Sarve Jana Sukhino Bhavantu. Thank you very much. Namaskar. Jai Hind.